Good morning and welcome to our Palm Sunday service this morning. Welcome to those who are in the Steckley's Chapel and to those of you who are watching online either now or later in the week. There we are. The Little Winter Warmer Tree. The ladies of the WMS would like to thank the community and the congregation for their support and donations in making this winter a little bit warmer for those people using our little winter warmer tree. Thank you to everyone helping to fill the tree and to everyone using the tree. See you in November. the butterflies for hope. As you can see, the tree is very full. And by your purchasing or supporting the Butterflies for Hope fundraiser, you've enabled us to continue supporting the WMS mission projects. Donations may be dropped off at the church office at Collier Street Church during the week or at the butterfly table after the Sunday service. You can also e-transfer your donations, including the information from your order form in the message box. Checks may be payable to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, and on the memo line, write Mark Butterflies. The Lenten study continues. We're having it at Collier Street United Church, and those of us who have been have found it very helpful. It will be extended one more week past Easter. So the last one will be on the 2nd of April at noon in the chapel at Collier Street. This Sunday's study will be led by Reverend Deacon Tom Lapp, who many of us know from when he came to St. Andrews. And of course, this being Easter week, there are many services, and we would ask you to support them. Maundy Thursday will be a joint service at 7 at Collier Street United Church. Good Friday is also a joint service at Collier United Church, and it's at 10 o'clock. There is a non-denominational service, a sunrise service, if you feel up to getting there for 7, at Heritage Park. So if you would like to join us, I was thinking, I don't know if I can open my eyes that early, but I might be there. We'll see. And then finally, our Easter Sunday services will be held here at Steckley Gooderham Chapel at 10. And there will be fellowship after downstairs. There will be hot cross buns. And that are the announcements for this morning. Thank you.
Good morning. So considering today is Palm Sunday, please turn to your neighbor and share this question. Are you the type of person who would join the crowd waving palm branches, or do you tend to sit on the side and observe? So in other words, are you a doer or an observer?
Are you a doer or an observer? How about you, Alex? Sit on the fence.
Well, you had a lot of fun doing that, okay? Shall we do our call to worship? On this Palm Sunday, we see Jesus entering Jerusalem riding on a donkey, showing us the way of peace.
With palm branches in hand, we cry, Hosanna! Save us now. Save us from our world madness.
We affirm that God is at work when people are ashamed of the inhumanity of war and work for peace with justice. We pray for peace to them who is the Prince of Peace.
Let us join our voices singing our opening hymn, Ride On, Ride On in Majesty, hymn 217. Let us come together for the prayer of adoration and confession, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. God of grace and truth, we gather in humility and hope because we believe you have the power to change the world, to change it for the better with your love. We gather because we believe no one is beyond your concern, no one is beyond your embrace. Such love astonishes us. Without your grace, we cannot even imagine such love. In this hour of worship, inspire us with a vision of love which will change the world and our lives for goodness sake. Let us come together to a moment of confession. Imagine Jesus entering our presence just as he entered Jerusalem some 2,000 years ago. Envision the palm branches, the donkey, the shouts of Hosanna, understanding who he is and knowing who we are. O God, you know us very well. You are quick to speak of faith, but slow to live it fully. We shout Hosanna as Jesus approaches, as did the people of Jerusalem. But we do not want him to come too close, not close enough to really see. We are quick to claim faith in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, but like the crowd who greeted his entry into Jerusalem, we are fickle, slow to live fully and everywhere as faithful disciples. We know where we fail. We are quick to want the blessings of faithfulness, but like the 12 who spent the last week with him, we are slow to accept the pain and suffering of authentic Christ-like living. Forgive our weakness and fear. Gently move us into service in your name as we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord is God. The Lord brings light to those in darkness, forgiveness to those who truly confess, and pardon to all who seek to follow Jesus. Rejoice that the steadfast love of the Lord endures forever. In the name of Jesus Christ, receive the love that never dies and never fails. Amen. Let us join our voices singing our next hymn, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna, hymn 218. And at this time, I invite the choir to please come on up. Yeah.
Our scripture readings are from Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2, and 19 to 29, and we will read this responsively. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he's good. His steadfast love endures forever.
Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever.
Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it.
I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation.
The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord.
The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar.
You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Our gospel reading is Mark chapter 11, reading verses 1 to 11, and it's Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately, as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" And they told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. How many of you have tried this optical illusion? Raise your hand. A few? Yes? Okay, that's okay. So before I begin my message, I would like all of you to focus on the four dots in the middle for 30 seconds. Just stare at the four dots. And afterwards, if you like, turn to the side, blank wall, and blink a few times and see if you can see something. And if you do, please raise your hand. Blink your eyes a few times and stare at a blank wall. Do you see something? Raise your hand. Yes. The face of Jesus. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. Blink your eyes. Yep. Good. I wanted to present this optical illusion, you see, to illustrate that there is more than meets the eye. The people of Israel perceived Jesus superficially, primarily based on what they witnessed him do, such as raising Lazarus from the dead. Similar to the optical illusion, consider the crowd that waved and shouted, "Hosanna." Do you believe they grasped the true implications of their cries? "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." As they waved palm branches, did they comprehend the profound significance of welcoming the Messiah King? Or did they merely follow the crowd, sharing the belief that this Messiah King, riding on a colt into Jerusalem, fulfilled prophecy, would overthrow the current political power to liberate God's people? Biblical scholar Joseph Dotson suggests that over time, the term Messiah evolved from a mere title for a contemporary king to that of an end-time figure, embodying eternal promise, such as the future son of David. The people, including the religious leaders, were keenly aware of this concept, as articulated by the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 to 7, declaring, "For to us a child is born, he will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom from that time on and forever." This declaration prompted the people to affirm their understanding of the Messiah King. The crowd waved and shouted, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who come in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest heaven." The crowd expected Jesus to set up a kingdom on earth, a kingdom in which they would be the rulers. They did not understand that this kingdom was spiritual, not political. This Messiah King, riding on a colt, not on a war horse, did not fit their idea of what the Messiah King would do. Jesus aimed to make a grand entrance, demonstrating to everyone present that he is the Messiah King. Jesus wants them to look beyond the surface, to see beyond mere physical miracles, and to grasp the deeper significance of his healing powers, to understand that it brings freedom, not only physically, but also spiritually, liberating people on a profound level. Perhaps, like the optical illusion I presented earlier, Jesus entered Jerusalem riding a colt to encourage the crowd and the religious leaders to look beyond their perceived notions of what the Messiah King should be. Maybe Jesus riding on the colt was intended to open their eyes and their hearts to perceive the true purpose behind this symbolic act. All four Gospels recount Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a colt, emphasizing not just any colt, but one that has never been ridden. And this detail suggests its suitability for a king, aligning with the prophetic imagery of Jesus' role as the Messiah King. By riding into Jerusalem, Jesus fulfills Zechariah's prophecy found in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, that reads, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion, shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victoriously, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." By entering Jerusalem in this manner, Jesus was publicly declaring himself as a long-awaited Messiah. In addition, Riding on a colt, a young donkey symbolized also humility and peace. In contrast to riding on a stallion, a horse, which was associated with war and conquest, riding on a donkey signified humility and gentleness. Jesus' choice of transportation conveyed his message of humility and peace as his role as a humble servant king. Biblical commentator Charles Campbell also asserts that Jesus comes not as one who lords his authority over others, but as one who humbly rejects domination. He comes not with pomp and wealth, but as one identified with the poor. He comes not as a mighty warrior, but as one who is vulnerable and refuses to rely on violence. The act of riding into Jerusalem on a colt also served to garner attention from the crowds. It was a deliberate public declaration of Jesus's identity as the Messiah, aimed at provoking discussion and reflection among the people during the Passover celebration. The significance of Passover for the people of Israel was to commemorate God's deliverance of them from slavery in Egypt. Jesus aimed to demonstrate to the people that he would deliver them from bondage and sin, promising them freedom and eternal life. Despite Jesus' intention to reveal his identity to the people of Israel, they only saw what they wanted to see. They did not deeply consider the significance of Jesus riding on a colt. Let's imagine ourselves, friends, imagine ourselves among the crowds, waving palm branches as Jesus rides in. When we wave our palm branches and shout, "Hosanna," it's essential to reflect on whether we truly believe Jesus to be the Messiah King. Are we merely going through the motions, or do our actions reflect a genuine recognition of Jesus' divine identity and sovereignty in our lives? When we witness our loved ones undergoing treatment and experiencing pain, it prompts a profound reflection on our faith. In such moments, we are challenged to ask ourselves whether we truly want to wave the palm branches as Jesus journeys with us through these trials. In the wake of tragic events like the terror attack in Moscow a few days ago, where more than 130 lives are lost and 100 or more are injured and the count continues to rise, we might question the significance of waving palm branches and following the crowd amidst such violence. When confronted with hate and suffering, we may wonder who Jesus is walking with. However, it's important to remember that Jesus walks with everyone who is hurting, dying, and questioning. Even in a secular world where the concept of Jesus as a Messiah King may seem irrelevant to some, his presence and compassion extend to all who are in need. And as we also commemorate Palm Sunday, the beginning of the Holy Week, it's crucial to draw parallels between the Israelites' Passover celebration and our own spiritual journey. Just as Passover reminded the Israelites of God's deliverance from slavery and darkness, Palm Sunday serves as a reminder of how Jesus arrives in our lives to deliver us from spiritual bondage and darkness. Jesus' entry into Jerusalem symbolizes his willingness to walk with us through our darkest moments, offering hope, redemption, and deliverance. As followers of Jesus Christ, we should reflect on his role as our Savior and King, recognizing his power to deliver us from hardship and lead us into the light of his love and grace. Palm Sunday invites us to recommit ourselves to following Jesus wholeheartedly, trusting in his saving grace and allowing him to guide us in our own journey of faith. So friends, perhaps our psalm reading this morning that Ruth read can offer us clarity, revealing that Jesus is indeed the Messiah King in our lives. The psalmist assures us that God's steadfast love endures forever. Throughout the history of the Israelites, we see that despite the hardships and obstacles they faced, God never forgot his people. Similarly, for us, despite the challenges as a church we have faced this past year, whether related to building issues or the visioning process, we take comfort in the enduring love of God. We trust that God will deliver us from the hardships of our current situation and guide us forward. The psalmist also assures us that God's salvation is a present and active reality in our lives. Biblical commentator Aubrey West states that one of the reasons the psalmist and we can be confident in God's enduring love is its manifestation over the long haul through God's saving activity. In other words, God's love is not just a fleeting emotion or temporary gesture. It is a continuous and steadfast commitment to his people, expressed through his actions to save and deliver us from various challenges and difficulties. And lastly, the psalmist reminds us that gratitude, being thankful, is fitting response of God's people. Confident in God's steadfast love and saving mercy, the psalmist responds and invites us to respond as well. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We are reminded once again that giving thanks to God is an act of prayer, as well as a reminder to our church family that each day is a gift from God and worthy of our praise. Let us hold the points of the psalmist close to our hearts as we read and reflect the psalm repeatedly. May we come to see Jesus for who he truly is, indeed, the Messiah King over all creation and all people. Jesus is not an optical illusion we conjure to fit our desires. No, he is everything to us. Let us hold onto the promise that God's steadfast love endures forever. Join me as I envision myself among the crowd on Palm Sunday, fervently shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the Messiah King." Amen. Before we continue our next hymn, Hosanna, I just want to just briefly share on Friday, our fun Friday, we had a wonderful turnout. One of our theme was the whole idea of journeying with Jesus. And our craft was a walking stick we made. And it's called, we put together two popsicle sticks, and with colorful yarns, we made what's called a God's eye. And in Spanish, it means ojo de Dios, which means making a God's eye is the idea that God is watching over us. So we place the God's eye on the bamboo stick, and it assures us that God walks with us each day on our spiritual journey. And we also decorated our walking stick and also attached a scripture, which also reminds us that we follow God's words as our life in our lives. So as we sing Hosanna, the folks at the back, are we ready with our walking sticks? They will proceed in. How creative is that? Thank you. seated. Beautiful, powerful. Let us come together for the prayers of the people. Let us pray. Loving God, on this Palm Sunday, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude and praise. As we recall the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, we are reminded of the excitement and anticipation that fill the air. Yet, we also remember the challenges and struggles that lay ahead for Jesus and his disciples. We pray for the unhoused in our communities and for refugees wherever they take shelter. For all who find themselves without enough resources to cope when necessary things are so costly. For those who live in isolated communities and lack the access, care, and technology most of us take for granted. We lift up to you all those who are facing challenges and difficulties in their lives. We pray for all those who have been humbled by unexpected circumstances, for those who face illness or injury, for those who know death or disaster, fear or failure, for victims of crime, and those who suffer through the misjudgment or mistake of others. We remember, O God, those who are suffering. Grant them strength and courage to face the trials before them, knowing that you are always with them. As we pray for our church community, that we may be united in love and purpose, seeking to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. May we be a beacon of hope and compassion in our world, sharing your message of love. On this Palm Sunday, help us to truly understand the significance of Jesus' journey to the cross. May we be inspired to live lives of humility, service, and sacrifice. We offer these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So, friends, as Holy Week opens, we remember what Jesus faced, how the crowd cheered him one day and called for his death. By week's end, close friends betrayed him and ran away. In our offering, we declare our love and loyalty to Jesus and that we are here for him. Please stand now for the doxology. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, compared with the gift you gave for our sake, what we offer today seems so small. Bless our gifts with your love so they accomplish more than we can even imagine. Bless our lives too, so that what we do and say will show we have the commitment to follow you, whatever the cost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us join our voices singing our closing hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor, hymn 214. As we leave this place of worship on this Palm Sunday, may we carry with us a spirit of humility and service, exemplified by Jesus Christ. Let us go forth into the world ready to share God's love, and may our actions reflect the joy and hope of this day. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you.